A conversation with John Canena is sponsored in part by Health Markets Insurance, your specialist for health, Medicare, small group, life, and supplemental. See our specialist, Maximilian Bujalski, for your insurance need. He is located at 7418 West Belmont Avenue in Chicago. Again, Health Markets is a proud sponsor of A Conversation with John Canena. And now on to our episode.
One. Good afternoon and welcome to another edition of A Conversation with John Canena. Today we are truly thrilled to have on a truly dynamic young man who is the CEO and president of A La Mode Foods here in Chicago. His unique brands of Vero Coffee and Gelato, Massa Cafe Italiano, Massa Pizza, and Gringo and Blondie Taqueria have really come on here in Chicago. The popularity, I'd have to say, is overwhelming. Everywhere you go, I've heard about this young man. Let me bring in this afternoon the CEO and president of A La Mode Foods this afternoon, Angelo Lolino. Angelo, I always start off this way. How are you doing and what is going on, young man?
How are you, John? Thank you so much for having me. We love your podcast.
Thank you.
We finally have the opportunity to be on it. So thank you for that.
Oh, this is great. I know we've been talking about this for a couple of years, and this is something else. And again, like I said, in my opener here today, and what I see around me at my desk and my notes and everything, I said this once to Antonio Romanucci, and I think this is the second time I'm going to say it now. And this is something after doing all these podcasts, we might need a part two with you before we do a part one. And so I got to ask you.
No problem. And thank you. Thank you for the kind words. It means a lot. Yeah. It's humbling to see where we've come, where we came from and to where we've come. So I'm truly blessed to have this.
I got to tell you, right off the bat here, me and you have something in common, and it's the year 1968. My father opened up this travel agency on West Belmont Avenue in 1968. And I notice here, of course, I had dealt with my father, had dealt with your father, and I've dealt with your dad too before. It looks like in 1968, Giuseppe Joe Lolino starts this dream here in Chicago of serving a cup of espresso and everything else. And you kind of like me get to see this kind of firsthand, and you're probably going there every day. How does this passion start? Does it start with dad? When does it start for Angelo Lolino?
Yeah, so it's really a dynamic, cool story, especially when, looking at it today, looking back on how the evolution of espresso and Italian food and all of that has come to life here over these years. But yeah, I was truly blessed to be born into an amazing business, an amazing family. My father came here in the late 60s with a dream to start roasting espresso coffee here. And he was literally one of the first to do it. If not the first. I'm sure there was somebody else roasting espresso. They were definitely people roasting coffee, but specifically espresso, there really wasn't many, if any at all. But yeah, so yeah, when I was born in 1971, he already had his bar, Cafe Bar Italia.
Right.
Which originally was on Chicago Avenue, then eventually moved to North Avenue, like North and Laramie there. and was basically the hub for Italians, right? It was really one of the only Italian bars. It was the first one. So all the Italians, obviously a lot of Bari's, people from Bari, because
yes,
my dad is from Bari, from Carbonara.
Carbonara.
But it was from everywhere. Calabrese, Sicilian, Northern Italian, people from Rome. I mean, I have memories of all these guys and all these families because I literally grew up with them. We got out of school, we went there, My mom cooked there, and you know that's where we grew up. So sure. I was fortunate and blessed to be able to see that whole evolution, right? So literally, you know, jumping around on coffee sacks as a little boy, watching my dad blend and roast coffee, and you know, smell and just, you know, get to experience all that. And then my mother came in right around the same time. Her parents were master tailors, and they were living in Florence. My mother's actually from Sicily, from Catania, but she was born and raised in Florence.
Wow.
Because that's where my grandparents were. And she had a strong passion for food, for culinary, but she was kind of acting as a beautician when she first got here, and then met my dad here and started cooking. And, you know, she would cook for us at the bar there. And
sure.
Again, you know, that whole thing evolved, right? My dad had had the soccer club, the Roosters, the soccer team that he managed. And, you know, after practice, they would all come. My mother would cook for him. And next thing you know, she's cooking for customers at the bar. And, you know, and then eventually, as you know, she opened up her restaurant. But, you know, speaking of the inspiration, it came from that. And
sure. You know, and I got to tell you, when I go back and look at the research, the research that I did, and of course, always correct me if I'm a little off here. You know, here nowadays, we are these, you know, we're always thinking of how to keep it going. And of course, you've taken this now to the next level. We'll get to that. But I found this amazing about your dad, that he brings in a guy from Rimini up north to bring in, you know, to help him with this whole idea of, you know, the master gelato thing. I mean, that's unheard of, you know, some 53, 4 years ago. I mean, do you remember even this as you, when you started with him as a young boy? Because you get involved pretty young.
I do, yeah. And that's how I learned gelato, from Nicola, from this gentleman that you're talking about. My dad brought him in to, he was a barista gelatiere, but a professional, right? And you know, as well as I know, in Italy, the bar, you know, having an espresso or having a gelato is a culture. It's not once in a while. So he was there. He was a really cool cat. He was probably 20-ish. I was a little guy, and he was living with us. So I got to spend a lot of time with him. When I would come to the bar after school, I would hang with him. You know, I would watch him make gelato, and he was so passionate, and he did so much cool decorating of the pans and
sure. Oh wow.
Yeah. So again, think about it. I'm there, and there's ice cream coming out of a machine and espresso, you know, brewing over here and coffee roasting. My mom's cooking, and you know, that's what inspired me ultimately to get into, you know, to get into the business.
Is it like your mid-teens? Like you said, you're coming from school, you're learning this, you know, like, just like for me, I would come after school just to deliver an airline ticket. I mean, how was it for you? Was it something where you says, you know what, God, you know, I could take the bull by the horns here. I can do this. I can make the coffee. I can, you know, when did you start to feel we're like, okay, you know, I got this. Cause I was always this type that I was going to show the old man that I could be as good and bad on the dance floor like him. When was it for you?
Yeah, I mean, that was always a thing. My brother and I were put to work at a young age. I don't even know what the age was, but
right.
As long as we could talk, walk, and move, we were doing something. We were working, but by our early teens, you know, it was, you know, out of school, go to work, you know, help my dad, help my mom and do those things. But, you know, I gotta be honest. I went through a period, John, where I have a strong passion for music and entertainment and that whole thing. And, you know, out of high school, I kind of thought that I was going to drive that lane of being in the music business. And I started with the DJing stuff. And then ultimately I started to do these concerts and dance parties, and we started to develop these local groups, and eventually I started a record label. We had a recording studio. We did all that. That was kind of like, you know, my 17, 18, 19, 20 year old, but I still had to work, right? I still worked with my parents, still worked with my dad.
Sure.
And, you know, the entertainment business is tough, you know, and I, you know, I had my son, I just turned 19. I started really young, Joey Giuseppe. And, reality hit me and it was like, all right, you got to start making some money here, man. You know, this music thing is great, but you know, we're looking for these hits and it's tough. Sure. So, the food business, John, it's the same thing where you're entertaining people, right? And that same feeling that I got if I had a concert and it was sold out and, you know, there were thousands of people there, to be on stage and to see that and to talk to them, or to have a group, you know, under our record label that was performing in front of people and people were singing along, and it gave me really, really big satisfaction. Not in front, more behind the scenes, you know, the food part of it, it gives me the same satisfaction. So eventually by my early 20s, I started to steer my focus away. I kind of got out of that full-time focus with that. And, you know, my brother and I helped build my dad's business and my mom's restaurant. And then ultimately we went on our own, but you know, that's another long story.
But you know what? Thank you for bringing that up, because again, you know, I can't Google that to find out that you were into the music and everything else. Yeah. That was just like me. I always wanted to do this and not be this travel guy. But then again, like you said, I loved what you just said. That reality hits you in the face and we got to make some money here and we got to make this and take it to a level now and try to do it now, because, you know, of course, growing up Italian like me and you, you know, our dads were those types, you know, what are you doing? You know, you got to be here. You got to focus and everything else. This is by now the late 80s or early 90s where you take it off with the Fratelli thing.
Yeah, Guy and I started, my parents unfortunately went through a divorce at that time, not to air the laundry, but it's a nice story because my parents are back together now after 30 years of being divorced. But
very nice.
So yeah, it's a part of life, right? So my parents went through a divorce, you know, they both came to this country with nothing, literally nothing. And they built a really nice business for them. Mm-hmm. If you look back, you know, I laugh when I'm telling a customer or a friend or somebody the story, like I'm telling you, like, wow, your father was the first one to do espresso, you know,
right?
Why aren't you living on some island somewhere, you know? You think back and, you know, there's an education level and an understanding level, and you know, that whole thing kind of got distorted for them and through this divorce. So my brother and I said, you know what, we're going to bail. We're going to go do our own thing here. You know, Italians, Europeans, they're not afraid to keep their kids involved in all that. Right. And we didn't want to have any part of it. So we went off, we did our own thing. And in 1994, 95, my brother Guy and I started Fratelli.
Right.
Fratelli Coffee and Gelato. And we literally borrowed $10,000 from a good friend of ours, Mike Haney's father, who is now dead. But Mr. Haney borrowed us $10,000 and we rented a little space. And I got to mention him, Pat Marisi from.
Harvard. Know him very well.
So, you know, I get the chills even talking about it. Pat, you know, we went to go see Pat and he kind of knew what was going on with my parents. So he kind of felt bad. And we said, hey, you got that for rent sign. It was a Harlem and Berry there, right in back.
Sure.
And we said, hey, can we rent that from you? He's like, no, I got all the units upstairs. I'll take you upstairs. And, you know, he had built that second story with a bunch of offices. Anyways, long story short, we looked at it. We're like, all right, how much? And he says, well, what are you guys going to do? And we, you know, we kind of told him, he's like, just do it. Don't worry about it. Just get started and, you know, don't worry. Anyways, it literally makes me emotional, man, when I think about it. Cause
but that's great. Yeah. Passion is coming out. Yeah.
And he gave us an opportunity that no one gave us. So we're forever grateful for him. But we started there, and then eventually we moved and we bought our own coffee roaster. We went and roasted our coffee with another roaster out in Bensonville, Vito D'Amore. Remember Vito D'Amore?
Sure, Vito D'Amore, sure.
Good guy, yeah, same thing. We went to him and he's like, yeah, whatever you guys want to do, do it. And Fratelli was born, and Guy and I grew that company from nothing. We eventually got bought out in the early 2000s. We did okay for ourselves with it. We were burned out, and we were just like, all right, we have an opportunity to get out, situate ourselves a little bit. And right around that same time, my wife and I opened Masa.
Yep.
And and that pretty much where everything started for us.
You know, again, to have that foresight, and again, just to remember Pat Mauricio Maurici, who had Harlem Meat there on Harlem Avenue for many years, that was a great client of ours. You know, but you had that foresight with you. You know, I admire this because you took the chance. You know, you took this chance and you go, but you had that passion right from there that you could do this. And it's going to transcend, of course, as we move forward here. But, and then, of course, now you go from Fratelli to this Masa, and now the whole ice cream thing. The fascinating part about this is the dedication that you and your brother had, because, you know, I was always afraid to make moves because I was always going to, I'm always still to this day in my father's shadow for some reason. But I just felt, listening to your story, you said, okay, I got this. We're going to do this. Let's give it a shot, you know. I find it amazing that you did the Fratelli thing, which was, like you said, a grind and a half, probably day in and day out. You know, I mean, it's not like you went there once a week and you had five guys working there. Is it done? You were hands-on there, correct? Oh,
yeah. Guy and I, yeah, I was sales and marketing. Guy was operations. My brother Guy did a great job selling too. He landed some of our biggest accounts. And look, we were just hustlers. We wanted more. We had started families, both of us really young. We wanted to do right by our family, and we didn't know any other way to do it, right? We knew it to do it in a legitimate way. And our parents were very hardworking, and that's all we knew. So we were ambitious. We wanted more out of life. We wanted to build a legacy on our own. And like you said, that reality of Italian parents, or let's talk about Italian fathers, you know, they're tough, man. Sure. They, you know, they sometimes don't have that mercy. They're not like we are today with my, you know, like I am with my kids, you know, compassionate, loving, I love you, great job. You know, my dad now tells me he loves me and, you know, great job, but
right.
Never. He would give me a slap before he was.
Yeah. Exactly. Or that look when you knew, oh God, you did it right. But in his eyes, you did it wrong. Got it.
Yeah. Or whatever. Right. Yeah. They, you know, I truly believe this, you know, they knew we were doing the right thing and they wanted it, but they didn't want to give us la soddisfazione to say,
yes,
oh, I got it now. I can relax. They didn't want that.
Exactly.
So, and that drove us. So we also wanted to prove to my father and our parents that we could make it happen. And we would not, Guy and I at the time would not take no for an answer. You know, we had kids at home, you know, we had wives that supported us, and it was like, all right, let's go, man. We gotta make this happen. And listen, there were days, John, where we would literally chase around the mailman for our mail to get our checks from customers, you know, because the accounts were overdrawn, and, you know, I was like, oh my God, what, you know, how are we going to pay it? And, you know, and we were blessed. We had good friends that supported us through the years, that when we needed money and we needed help, you know, $1,000, $2,000, you know, we weren't afraid. We were like, hey, listen, we're jammed up. We need a little help. We'll get it back to you next week. And we did it. And then, you know, eventually, you know, it started to catch on. And
And Angelo, these are the things that I'm glad you're bringing up, because, you know, people think, oh yeah, you open the door. Oh yeah, a la Mode's Foods, they're making millions. Yeah. But what you just said now, you know, you knew what you had to do to make it work, or, and you knew the lean weeks and the rough quarters and everything else. And the, to get that for, you know, my dad had this great line: to get a client so hard and then so easy to lose. And that always stuck in my head. I have to bring up something, because I want to bring this up to you. Fratelli Lolino, which what it was it called with you and Guy. Is that still part, is that coffee and the gelato?
It was, yeah. And then, my, like I said, my brother and I sold it in the early 2000s. I stayed on board there. Guy went into the maintenance, general maintenance business.
Got it.
Started a company called CLM Midwest, or CNL Maintenance, and then it turned to CLM Midwest. I stayed on with the gentleman that bought it, Sam, another great guy, Sam Zarconi.
Mm-hmm.
And I stayed on for 12 months. I had Masa at the time. And finally, after a year, you know, he wanted me to stay on and run the company, but, you know, our visions weren't aligned. And, you know, when you're not, right, you got a guy like me, man, you cage me up, it's a problem. You know what I mean? Sure. Meaning I'm too ambitious and aggressive, and I want to, you know, so we parted ways amicably, and it was great. And I signed a non-compete, and I couldn't really do coffee or really anything wholesale-ish with gelato. So I said, you know what, I'm going to grow Masa. And I fine-tuned our original location from 1999 in Elmwood Park there on North Avenue. Sure. I fine-tuned that menu, and I was blessed to have an opportunity to open up at Navy Pier. I opened up a seasonal spot there. I opened up another one at University Village, Roosevelt and Halstead there. And I had this dream to, you know, continue, yeah, to open up Masa's and maybe one day franchise them, whatever. When my brother and I had Fratelli, we spent a lot of time training on espresso and cappuccino and lattes and what to buy, what not to buy, equipment layout, and training on gelato and how to make gelato. And we spent a lot of time helping a lot of people develop their, sure, business. So I figured, you know what, I'm going to do it for myself. You know, I'm going to continue to do it. And, you know, a really cool story, 2008.
You're going to steal my thunder on this one, but go ahead. You mean,
no, yeah, you can bring it up, but I'll stop at the point of saying, you know, I had gotten to three Masa's, and then I opened up a Japanese restaurant called Inari Sushi.
Oh, wow.
Which was inspired by my cousin, who is one of the pioneers, an Italian, Franco Gianni. His family were in the furniture business, Gianni Furniture. They were high-end custom custom office manufacturers. But anyways, he was on the culinary side of the family. He wanted to be, and he opened up a great sushi spot, the original Sushi Wabi on Randolph. When Randolph was still, Luca Packing was down there, JP Graziano, it was still a meat packing. But anyways, he inspired me to open that. So I had gotten to that point where I'm like, you know what, I'm going to start to venture out and do some other stuff. And then, go ahead, what were you going to say?
Well, then I think in 2008, you hook up with a guy by the name of Bobby Mariano, correct?
Right on, yeah.
Yeah, right. And I mean, that story in itself, and now I'll let you do the rest. I mean, for you, was it like, were you wowed by this? I mean, he was at the time with Roundy's, correct?
Yeah, actually what happened was I got a call from a gentleman that acted as a mentor to me and a dear friend in my business career, Dominic DeFrisco, who you obviously know.
Oh, sure.
Knew very well.
What a genuine man.
Just a Chicago icon, Italian-American, everything. You know, he was all about Italian-American, everything, right? It so happened that Dominic's daughter, Nina, who is part of my family, married Bob. And so I guess story has it that Bob and Dominic were having dinner, and they were conceptualizing this new Chicago store. And he told Dominic, hey, I want to do an authentic Italian cafe in there. I did the Starbucks thing when I was with Dominic. I want to do something that's our own, something that's unique. And, you know, who do we have here, you know? And Dominic said, you got to talk to Lolino. You know, Angelo, the kid, you know, kid knows what he's doing, So I got a call from Dominic that night. Hey, Bob Mariano's going to call you tomorrow. You know, make sure you take his call. It's 414, you know, and make sure you take care of him. That's my, I think it was at the time going to be his future son-in-law. I think they just had gotten engaged. I don't remember exactly, but anyways, I got the call from Regina, from Bob's secretary, the next day. And she said, Mr. Mariano and Mr. Fitzgerald would like to come and meet with you. And, you know, I'm like, yeah, okay. I really couldn't do anything in the coffee business because I was under the non-compete.
Got it.
So I didn't think much of it because, you know, Dominic was all about helping people, right?
Sure.
And Dominic was a lot, hey, come and serve espresso at this event. And, you know, you got to support this. And, you know, so Dominic was about giving back and helping people out. So in my mind, I was like, all right, I got to help Bob Mariano out. But I knew who Bob was, obviously, because I was in the food business, right? And he was one of the main reasons why Dominic's became what it became. Ultimately, the DiMatteo family did a great job, but he came in and had this vision for the fresh store and really grew it. So very, very long story short, I met with Bob at Masa in Elmwood Park, and it was 2008. Dominic's store number 2 is right across the street from Masa. Now it's a Fresh Time, but that
over there
was
in River Forest, correct?
Yeah, over in River Forest. So, you know, Bob sat there and emotionally talked about, you know, the time that he spent in that store and how ironic it is that he's here now. And, you know, he was upset talking about how Safeway let the stores go and they weren't neighborhood stores anymore. And, you know, he was just telling me all these stories and I was so intrigued, right? And I didn't know a lot of the details about what was going on. And ultimately he said, look it, you know, I with a private equity firm, we bought this wonderful company out of Wisconsin, Milwaukee, called Roundy's Supermarkets. And, you know, we have a consortium of stores that are that we run and operate. There are some owner operators still under the Pick and Save, which I knew, you know, Pick and Save, Rainbow Markets in Minnesota, and Cops were in like Madison and Green Bay. And, we have 100 something stores, and, you know, I want to come back to the Chicago market. I think there's an opportunity to come back. And I want to put this cafe in there, and I'm looking for, you know, a good source for coffee and help. And, you know, they obviously had, you know, they drank the espresso like, wow, this is amazing. And,
sure.
You know, I know your parents, and, you know, he talked about my mom, my dad, and Baritalia. And he remembered all that because my dad's coffee, Cafe Italia, was in the stores at Dominic. So,
yes.
Yeah. Anyways, I said, yeah, cool. I'll help you out, whatever you need. And, you know, I said, you should think about gelato too. So I brought them up to the gelato display case at Masa. And I said, you know, you should consider that. And he's like, oh, what do you think? And I'm like, yeah, I think you do coffee and gelato. I think you knock it out of the park, you know? And he loved it. So, you know, I'll never forget him. We were there for 2 hours, him and Don Fitzgerald, who is they're still together. Another unbelievable human being in my life. They went outside and I went in the little office at Masa, and the office at Masa is literally, you know, it's tiny.
Right. Not, right.
You know, it's like 4x4. And I went in there and I got on the computer, and I mean, you couldn't really go on your phone at the time. You must have not have, because I went in on the computer. I had Don's card. And I looked up Roundy's just to kind of see, you know, where they were at. And I'm looking at it. I'm like, wow. I mean, they did like 4.something billion in revenue and gross revenue.
Wow.
They were still privately held and all that. But, you know, and then I'm looking up Bob Mariano, and, you know, he had commercials up there. They called him Chairman Bob. Chairman Bob approved. He used to go to the farm where they got the oranges, and he right. would test them, and they had this whole little cool thing. So I was like, wow. And I'll never forget, I kind of leaned back and they were both standing outside still, and Bob was pointing, and, you know, he was all into it. And I'm like, wow, that's cool, man. You know, let's see. So the next day I'm going to send Don an email saying, hey, it was great to meet you. And I was like, you know what? They'll reach out to me if, you know, if something's going on.
Sure. Sure. Whatever.
And I kind of left it be. And then, I don't know, 2 weeks later, I got a call from Don apologizing. Sorry, it took me so long. We're in the middle of things. Do you mind if I send a couple people down to see what you're doing and talk to you? And I'm like, sure, send them down. No problem. So he sent Karen Franceschi and Todd Willits. They came down, food and drink, and they were like blown away. They invited me up to a meeting up in Milwaukee. I show up, red carpet, boardroom, you know, talking.
Wow.
Busted out the blueprints, and they had it printed on the blueprint. It said Angelo's Italian Specialties. And they had a gelato case. They had an espresso machine. It was like a bird's eye view of the store. And they had a little cafe built out, designed in it. And at that point, I was just kind of like, wow, what are we doing here? And, you know, I kind of asked Don, I'm like, what's the deal? And he said, listen, Bob wants you with us. We want you here with us. Let's get it figured out. You know, I had another year and a half left on my non-compete. And he said, we're probably a year and a half away, 2 years away from opening up the first store. Let's continue down this path. And ultimately, I was blessed enough to sign a licensing deal with them. I developed the brand. Bob asked me to develop a brand. I developed the brand Vero Coffee and Gelato. And we opened up 44 Mariano's. And we opened up another 16 stores up in the Wisconsin market under Metro Market and all that. And I spent 13 years of my life working with these guys, literally wow. shoulder to shoulder. I spent 90 something days at the first store in Arlington Heights. And if you remember when that first store opened, and I got to tell you, you know, when Bob was telling me about this, I was just kind of like, man, I don't know. There's not really room for another independent grocery store, Italian. You know, you had Tony's, you had Caputo's,
right.
You had Trader Joe's was kicking some butt, you know, Whole Foods and, you know, all the small independents. And
sure,
I didn't really see it. But honestly, John, I didn't know what, you know, really what he was talking about. You know, he would talk about this prepared food section and, you know, he had all this lingo that I really didn't.
It was new to you. You're right, right, right.
Yeah, it was kind of new to me. Yeah. You know, these guys are innovators, man. And, you know, so they're thinking ahead. So anyways, you know that after that first store opened in Arlington Heights, it was literally like a boom, man. It was like the next best thing since sliced bread.
Right.
And I spent 96 days in that store. But as a part of that, I ended up helping them on the culinary side, right? I got pulled out and, you know, and helped out with their pizza program and their hot foods program. And, you know, I kind of got involved with things more than just sure. cafe. And, you know, those guys, I was able to build this facility because of it. I learned the whole grocery business because of it, and they paid me to do it, you know? So, you couldn't pay for that education that those guys gave
me. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Priceless. And that is priceless. What you're just saying.
You have no idea what I learned and the devotion and gratefulness that I have to those people that
oh, sure.
you know, Bob Mariano gave me a shot. He didn't, you know, I wasn't at that point yet in life where I had completely proven myself. But, you know, he says it to today, you know, he's like, man, I seen it in you. You know, I knew you were hardworking and I really liked your vision. And you know what? I busted my butt for them, man. I worked as much as I needed to work. I did what I had to do. And I was super loyal because at that point, then I started to get the phone calls from everybody else. Hey, we want to do gelato in our stores. We want to do gelato stores. And Bob would have. Yeah, he would have.
I mean. Angelo, I mean, and I remember that when that all started and I was going to places and seeing, you know, like, wow, you know, whose ice cream is this? Who's ice? You came onto the scene like gangbusters from that point on. It was just amazing. And I just want to stop here for a second because I should have done it about 50 minutes ago, but I got so into this conversation with you. We are visiting today with Angelo Lolino, the CEO and president of Alamode Foods. And And this, of course, is going to go out to the public on YouTube and Spotify in about a couple of days. But I have to tell you, before we continue to talk about this, Angelo is not only the CEO and president, his wife, Giovanna Lolino. And I have to say something to Giovanna to compliment her even more here. Behind every good man is a great woman. And this is really a great woman because she's got some Molaise blood in her like me. And, and I remember her father. And of course, your production manager is your son, Joey Lolino. And of course, we have your daughter here is involved also, Gianna,
yeah, she's working with us. Yeah, we have
Gianna's involved, and we have a lady by the name of Stephanie if I'm pronouncing it, Liepart. Liepart. Yeah,
she's and my right arm here.
And then we have Vicente Villa Fuerte. Villa Fuerte, and of course Rich Cleary, Omar Modrogan, and Cruz Ramirez. This, your crew here, I just wanted to bring them up because this is an amazing story of how now you take it to this level with all these unique brands that I mentioned here at the beginning of this, you know, the Masa's Gelato, the coffee, the pizza, the food, the, I mean, just incredible, the taqueria, everything. Did you ever envision, I know I jumped ahead a little bit, did you ever envision from this thing in 2008, that you get to this level, but you had a confidence brewing in you probably because of what happened in 08.
Yeah, Did I ever anticipate the Mariano's thing to do what it did? Absolutely not. I had no idea. But it was literally a whirlwind, you know, when we were at that period where we were opening 4 to 5 stores a year. And then he ended up buying like 11 or 12 Old Dominic stores. So we did 16 stores in 1 year. I mean, I didn't put my head up once, you know, and again, they paid me very well. And it wasn't like I was doing them a favor. It was a mutual great relationship. And we, you know, collectively kicked some ass. I mean, we did some really, really cool things. And then, you know, he ended up taking the company public. Which was amazing to witness, right? To be a part of that and to watch that whole thing happen. And then, you know, and then ultimately selling it to Kroger and, you know, semi-retiring and, you know, now absolutely crazy enough, you know, I'm back working with them, as they started another concept now.
And sure.
They just announced store number 3 and it's called Dom's Kitchen and Market. And I'm blessed that the folks at Kroger that took it over, supported us. They didn't, you know, they didn't cut us off because they could have. And if they would have, I would have been done, you know, but sure. I knew, and, you know, Bob told me, you know, after the sale, you know, I met with them, I was obviously nervous and, you know, he told me, look, they like what you're doing. They like Vero. They like the gelato. He said, they're Starbucks people. They have a lot of their Kroger stores have Starbucks and, you know, at some point they'll probably convert, you know, some of the stores and, you know, but he said, they like what you're doing. You're fine. He's like, but you need to spread your wings a little bit and we're here to support you. Right. So at that moment, this facility here in Franklin Park was a little bit smaller. I didn't have as much space as I have now. Was 99%, John, Roundy's, Mariano's. That's all I did. I had the restaurants, and Giovanna was running the restaurants. I was focused here, but I was like, man, if I lose this, I'm done. I mean, I'm literally bankrupt. I could never sustain it. I wasn't able to, you know, put my kids through school and, you know, we live modestly. We live in Elmwood Park, you know, and we love Elmwood Park, but you know, right. It's not like I moved out to Inverness or, you know, did, you know, made crazy moves. I tried to keep my feet planted and do it. But my point is, you know, we're Italian Americans. We come from a culture of quality, of hard work, of dedication, of devotion. Family is everything. There's so many good things. And, you know, I've been so blessed to be encountered by so many good people that have supported and helped me because without that, I couldn't do it. And again, after that meeting with Bob, I really had to check myself and say, okay, what are you going to do? there's no guarantees, even though you have a contract. If these people want to be done, they can be done. So that fear that, you know, what am I going to do? Yeah. I started to wholesale again, and I went back into the wholesale, and I started one by one to pick up new accounts. And I was blessed, man, because
sure.
You know, you think about Robertino Presta and the whole Caputo family and his wife and that whole family, they supported me immediately, and I couldn't support them back then. Right. And they wanted me to, and I couldn't do it because I couldn't do that to Bob. You know, Dominic Gambino from Tony's has been very supportive, and you know, and his partner Tony, and Eddie Greco, he was the first guy I called, and I said, hey, this is what's going on. He knew. He's like, don't worry about it. He came by, he looked at it, he says, all right, we'll start doing distribution for you. Don't worry. Well, you're good. You got a great product. Stay focused on quality. And you know, so little by little, you know, the Rosebud chain, and you know, Scott Harris at Francesca's, and Steve Lombardo at Gibson's. And the Dynamic Group, and we were just so blessed to you know, connect with the right people. And but you know, look, at if you're not doing the right thing and you don't have integrity, and you know, these people are not going to support you. So
exactly, and you know, but you know, I didn't think that this was going to go this way. But what you brought out today, and we could talk here for another 2 hours. I mean, your time is valuable, everything else. I mean, you've won these championships for the gelato, the coffee. But what came out of this interview today for me, because I wasn't expecting this from you, is how from your father, how you complimented your father, and then you bring up all these people that we all know well here in Chicago that, you know, you gave them the kudos. And I got to tell you this, Angelo, and I'll leave you with this because we have to do a part two, because this definitely was the tip of the iceberg here today. I have to tell you, the reason why these people, and of course, I know what you said about Bob Mariano and what he saw in you, but you know what? If I had to change your name, and looking at you today and listening to this story, which gives me goosebumps, your name should have been Dedication and Perseverance, because that should be your marker, because you are on it every day. I'm a big social media guy. I'm always creeping and looking and seeing from ideas for me to keep myself going, this 64-year-old guy. And it's that drive and determination that makes Angelo Lolino do what he does. Angelo Lolino, you keep doing what you're doing, because this story is fantastic. And you just got to promise me two things. That you'll come back for a part two, and I need to gain some more weight. If you can have me on as a taste tester Tuesday,
you got it. Done. Both of them are done. Count me in, and thank you for everything you do, and your family. What they've done for my family, and the plane tickets and the trips to Italy. And last year you helped me with my trip to Italy, which was amazing. You guys do an amazing job there. So. Kudos to you too, brother.
Angelo, just a fantastic, keep doing what you're doing, because this is just, like I said, it's unbelievable. And another thing, I should have brought it up earlier. You even, I think, was it, you went to school, a very famous place called Prodotti Stella Corsi di Gelato.
In Italy, yeah.
Yes. And that's a famous place that was always mentioned. So just unbelievable. And, I could see that the future will only continue to get better for you, young man.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate it.
You got it. We'll get this out to you soon. This will be out on YouTube and on Spotify so we can all hear Angelo's story. And to everyone, thank you and have a great day.
Ciao.
Ciao.